Hey everybody, this is Rainbow Reviews. Welcome back to my short form videos. This is going to be a quick video where I just kind of catch up on some Rick and Morty episodes. I want to do more videos like this in the future, you know. This is unscripted. I'm going off like rough notes, but yeah, it's just me here. So, as always, you know, my Redbubble is here and my Instagram is here. If you want to see the full body version of this outfit, it'll be on Instagram. More Redbubble stuff. I've started to put more stuff on there recently. So yeah, if you want to support this channel, go check that out. Now let's just get right into this video. Today we're catching up on Rick and Morty Season 5. I meant to do like episode reviews like I did for Final Space, but I was just getting burnt out with creating the Final Space format, and I just wanted to do something a little bit more like this. You know, I'm still trying to see what works on my channel and what doesn't, and what's good for, like, what's fun for me to edit and what's fun for me to make. So, whatever you want, just let me know in the comments, and I'm not going to delay this any longer. Let's just get right into the Rick and Morty Season 5 episode reviews. So, Season 5's opening episode is Mort Dinner Rick Andre. Right off the bat, I don't get the reference with the name. I know it's like some kind of old movie or something. That's out of my ballpark, I'm sorry. But it is a great season starter that feels a lot like a classic episode of Rick and Morty. And you've heard people critique these episodes already, critique past episodes of past seasons. You know that when someone says it feels like a classic episode, that's a very good thing. In my opinion, this is a very good season opener. So basically the plot of this episode is Rick and Morty are crashing in Rick's ship. They crash into the ocean and Rick's nemesis comes out of the ocean and he wants to have dinner with him, like treaty stuff. Okay. And Morty calls up Jessica and they're actually going to go on a date. So right off the bat, I love that they were kind of progressing Jessica's character. She was just kind of a background character before, and we haven't seen that much of her in this capacity. So, basically the A-plot is Rick and his nemesis, Mr. Nimbus, just kind of talking, Rick's being an asshole to him, whatever. And Morty is going through a quote-unquote Narnia door to get Jessica some wine, and to get Rick some wine at the same time. It's a classic, like, you know, don't have time for this, gotta do this, coming back to this, pretending like there's nothing else going on. It's, you know, it's been done before, which I didn't love. This episode plot was so kind of, not want to say mundane, but a lot simpler than, say, the next episode, but we'll get to that later. So, this episode, in my opinion, it moves a little too fast. I don't know if anybody else thought this when they watched it, but it goes like, bam, 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 bam. There's no time to breathe here, which that can work to its benefit sometimes, but here I felt like if they maybe could cut out a couple things and it would still deliver the same impact. But you know, it's a small nitpick. I haven't seen anybody else talk about it like this, so I don't know, maybe it's just me. It's not anything that ruins the episode, you know? And by the end, spoiler alert, Jessica does not become a bigger character in the show. You know, maybe it's like a philosophy of the writer's room, like you can't have smaller characters become more serialized because you can run out of writing potential for them or something. But, you know, it's whatever. I was really hoping she could be a bigger part of the show moving forward, but it's fine. So, in my opinion, the best Rick and Morty episodes are the ones that play with original ideas and do a ton of stuff with it. And with this episode, it's the time dilations with the Narnia door. Like, Morty will go through it, time will be sped up a lot, so time is different, and that leads to a whole bunch of hilarious situations. Comedy built off these played-out concepts, that's a great thing to do, and it's great screenwriting-wise. So I really appreciate that they did something like that with this episode. Overall, this episode was a great start to the season. Nothing too iconic immediately, but it's pretty good. Okay, Mortyplicity is my second favorite episode this season. I don't have a lot to say about it, but basically the plot is that there's an Asimov cascade, as they call it in the episode, where there's clones, creating more clones, leading to a cascade of clones, and I gotta say, this is a really cool concept. You know, there's two kinds of Rick and Morty episodes. There's ones with A-B plots, where there's two different stories happening, and most of the comedy comes from the writing. The writing that has not a lot to do with the overall story. The jokes, I mean, not having a lot to do with the overall story. And then there's other episodes where it's one story, and it's all one concept that the writers cooked up, and just lead it in really interesting directions. And those are my favorite episodes, because they can take these ideas, the ideas about an Asimov cascade, and lead them into really clever, like, you know, filmmaking techniques. And in this one, it just blows up until a clone Rick challenges them all to a fight, leading to a self-destructing cascade, which is really cool. Like, it started out where we saw one Smith family being killed by squids, and then we saw another Smith family, so we're like, oh, okay, they're the real family now. Nope, they get killed by another Smith family, so we're like, okay, so this is the real Smith family then. Now we're into the episode, for real. And then they get killed by another Smith family, and we're like, huh? It's just gonna keep going? And I will say, this episode is really clever with its misdirects. Every time we see a new family, we think it's the actual real one. And I was surprised how many times they were able to misdirect me here. At least 6 or 7 times. So, really, Mortiplicity is just a really cool episode, and it is my second favorite episode this season. Seeing a lot of, like, videos on the internet, I know Captain Midnight made a video. Love his videos, by the way. He said that he didn't really like this episode. I kind of have to disagree. I really liked it, and it is one of my favorite of the season so far. But, you know, in the comments, if you've seen this episode, let me know what you think. If you liked it, if you didn't, we can talk about it. But for me, I really enjoyed it. A Rick Convenient Mort. It's pretty good. Off the bat, I'll just say it's pretty good. Although, in my opinion, it's one of the weaker episodes of this season. I don't know if anybody else feels that way. I'll explain it. It's probably kind of a hot take. So basically, in A Rick Convenient Mort, obviously the name is a spoof on An Inconvenient Truth about global warming and climate change. It's like it's a film that came out a while ago. So this episode is about Morty and Planetina, which is like a Captain Planet parody. They are in like a relationship, and this makes Morty come into conflict with the Planeteers, and that's a pretty cool concept by itself. And this episode doesn't have a lot of Rick in it. It has a lot of Beth and Morty kind of bonding, and we've never gotten to see this bonding between Beth and Morty this far. So it's a unique episode, and there is a B-plot with Rick and Summer, I just remembered. It's not a very consequential subplot, but it does have Rick kind of going back into his, you know, his romantics, which we don't see a lot of, you know, him trying to set up a relationship with this alien. And that was really curious. It's not really like Rick to do what he did in this episode. That might be some theory fodder. I know Game Theory already did a theory talking about this B-plot and why it's just kind of strange. This episode is a romance plot between Morty, Planetina, and Rick and this alien. Romance plots are never my favorite. I know I said I liked the first episode and that was a romance plot, but it had the cool Narnia door thing, and this one doesn't really have anything like that, but it is cool to see Morty kind of go through these emotional stages of when he's, you know, swept off his feet and he's in love with Planetina now, and then he's really like ready to kill people for her, and then he realizes what he's got himself into. It is a good progression of those emotions, and I've gone through those emotions before too. It's very accurate. And Morty and Planetina do have an interesting end to their relationship, and I appreciate what the writers did to give the relationship a bad ending. Planetina starts murdering, like, thousands of people for the, air quotes, good of the planet. But, you know, I kind of knew that's where it was going, but it was still really well done. The relationship, while kind of a tired trope for an episode, was really well done. Honestly, I'd say this is a pretty middle-of-the-road episode for Rick and Morty and for the season in general. It's the most okay-ish out of the season. There's not much else to say here about this one. Rick-dependent spray. Oh my god. What the hell? I mean, I'm sure a lot of people had this same reaction. Basically, the plot of this episode is Morty finds a machine at his mother's horse hospital where she works at, and he does some stuff with the machine, and it creates these monsters from his, what did Beth call it? Just stuff. I don't know. Okay. And then they have to get Summer's egg to kind of distract them, and then they accidentally fuse together, the president gets involved, it escalates into this whole thing. Oh boy, this is definitely one of the weirder episodes of Rick and Morty, and they even acknowledge this in the show themselves. It's just kind of strange. We haven't really had an episode where Morty keeps a secret from Rick, though. Morty is trying to not let it get out that he's the one that created these monsters, and I'm surprised that Rick didn't figure it out. But the dynamic is new, and it gives the episode a pretty unique feel to it. It's like unique pacing, the liar revealed plot, which is never a good thing, but in here it is played for comedy, so it is more enjoyable there. It's something I can appreciate. So, although I like the difference in pacing, it was just one of those episodes where you're like, God, parents, do not come down here and see what I'm watching, please. I could never explain it to you. So even though the episode is strange, it does have a pretty good climax with some fighting and a pretty funny payoff with the monster that Morty befriends fusing with the egg and actually creating a baby. There is some good jokes in this episode. And of course it's Summer's egg. Why the hell not? I mean, just make it weirder, you know? Also, I guess Rick is a furry. Go figure. So, Amortican Griffiti, another, you know, parody title, is my favorite episode of the season so far because, for one simple thing, both its stories are very strong and very well written. Let me explain. So the plot of this episode is Rick and Jerry are going to this hang out with these aliens, and it turns out these aliens feed off of, like, cringe, and that is just a really cool concept to me. Aliens that feed off of cringe. It's not really something we've seen before, or at least I haven't, or I can't think of it. And, you know, of course Jerry takes him into a nightclub and he's like, oh guys, they're playing Smash Mouth. And just, like, recalling it, it's just funny. I don't know. And then the other plot is Morty and Summer are trying to invite this dude over. It's just Morty's trying to make a friend, and Summer's really trying to get on his good side, because, you know, it's Summer, come on. And he's like this kid who just hasn't experienced, like, he hasn't been embarrassed at school yet, so he's like a really good prospect to have as a friend. And that's just like, yeah, we did that, you know, as teens, you do weird stuff like that. And it's just really relatable and funny. So that's the plot, but also, Morty and Summer take this new kid into Rick's ship, and just like the Keep Summer Safe episode, we have Rick's ship actually being a character here and talking to Morty and Summer and this other kid. And that's just like, I loved that character in that scene, and I surprisingly didn't get tired of her in this episode. You know, there's a lot of really good comedy that comes with this. She's like a really satirical character, like, ah, you're such a bitch. Like, it's just really funny. And basically, the idea that Rick can hang out with a Jerry raises some immediate red flags in the episode. We're like, oh yeah, okay. There's something going on here. Rick's just not going to hang out with Jerry just because. And the concept that creatures that feed off of cringe, that's funny on its own. They didn't take it quite all the way as I would have liked to. Like, they made some good jokes about it, but they do poke fun at the sheer ridiculousness. Like, oh, well, if that makes you feel good, it makes you feel bad, but it also makes you feel good again, right? Like, it's cool, but it's weird. They just do it really, really well. They do make a lot of good jokes out of this ridiculous concept for aliens. So overall, this was my favorite episode. I know I didn't explain it super well. I just really think that it's strong on all fronts. There were a few really good jokes. I laughed out loud a couple times. And this was just an overall fun episode. That's one of my favorite episodes of the show are. They're just plain fun. They don't have to be too clever, you know, or like do some weird back foreshadowing things like Primordius did, which is a good episode. This one I can just have fun with. And that's why I really like this episode, and it's my favorite of the season so far. This is the Thanksgiving one. I do not remember what its name is. I just remember that it was really long, and I don't feel like looking it up, really. It's such a long name. But anyway, this episode is about, like, Thanksgiving, really. Rick and Morty are in the cold open, gonna steal the Declaration of Independence, like Nicolas Cage style, and that's a funny reference. But basically, this episode is about Rick and the president being on bad terms, and Rick trying to get a presidential pardon by becoming that turkey that they do every year. I forgot they did that, really. It's not really, like, you know, kind of televised or, like, it's not what we're famous for, like a holiday or anything. It's just it's a cool concept for an episode. Rick trying to become this turkey, and the president's always, like, one step ahead of him or behind him. And it's out of all the episodes this season, this one had the smoothest pacing. I don't know if anybody else feels this way. Everything started out small and then escalated quickly. It started out as Rick becoming a turkey and that's it. And it escalated into murdering all of these other turkeys, having giant hybrid giant turkeys, and fighting them, and going to space. And I love those episodes where it starts out small, and then gets bigger, 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 like a cascade, like Mortyplicity. I love those kinds of cascading episodes. One thing I do wonder about this episode is, I wonder how they were able to animate fighting turkeys that were fighting like humans. I feel like that would be really hard to kind of nail down, and I think in the after episode sort of talk, they did go over a little bit, but I really would have liked to see the process like that, because it would be an interesting thing to learn how to animate. So, okay. I'm not a huge fan of the president character in the Rick and Morty universe, just because he hasn't been in the strongest episodes. I mean, he debuted in Get Swifty, which is one of the best episodes, might be my favorite of the series, but, you know, when the Rick Churi and Morty did it, he just didn't really stand out, I guess. So episodes centered around him tend not to be my favorite, but here, he kind of reminded me like Charlie Day in It's Always Sunny, where you tell him something's crazy. Where you tell him something crazy and he's like, that's what they want you to think, you know? Like, I'm the mastermind, I'm one step ahead of them. It's a great way to take his character, and I think if they're gonna bring him back in more episodes, they should keep making him be like that. I think it's a great way to take his character. So overall, I think this season's been pretty good so far. You know, not maybe as, doesn't have as many strong episodes as past seasons do. Like, nothing truly iconic has really stood out to me so far, but there's plenty of episodes left in the season for that to happen. Actually, there's like 4 left, so not like a whole lot, but they could make something really good. I'm really excited for this Voltron episode. I want to see what that's about. So, you know, this season's still going on. I will continue to cover these episodes in a weekly fashion moving forward. I want to get back to weekly videos. Not necessarily Fridays at 3 p.m, but if I can do that, hey, all better for the channel. I want to get to know you guys more, get to talking, instead of working on a video for like 3 weeks and then it just does like okay. I want to, even if the videos don't do great, I just want to get my opinions out there. I think it's going to be better for the future. So, with that said, this is one of my quick videos, not very short in length compared to my other ones, but not a lot of editing, but you don't really care about that stuff, it's whatever. I hope you guys liked this shorter format. I want to continue doing more videos like this in the future, where I don't spend so much time editing, and I'm just talking. But, you know, if you liked it, let me know in the comments, and I will keep doing it. I plan to. Just let me know what you guys want to see. As always, I'm going to make what you guys want to see. We can get a good middle ground between what is fun for me and what you like. So again, thank you for 110 subscribers now. I'm at 111 at the time of writing this script, or writing the rough draft of this script, doing the voiceover. So yeah, thank you guys for your continued support of my channel. I really didn't think I'd make it this far, especially this quick. I've only been doing YouTube for a little over a year, so I'm very lucky to have you guys as an audience. So thank you for sticking with me. Check out my Redbubble. It's in the description. We got new t-shirts. Check out my Instagram if you want to see the full body version of this outfit. Yeah, I really like this outfit. I think it's cool. The full body drawing is even cooler. So do check that out if you are interested in that. So thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you next time. Get swifty. Stay swifty.